Hi, I'm Mary Sue Rominger. I chair the board of directors for the Bateman Horn Center. Welcome and thank you so much for being here tonight and for joining us, especially those via Facebook and those in the audience. We will be posting a video of tonight's presentation on the Bateman Horn Center YouTube channel in the next few days. We plan to do a Q&A session in the program later on, so for those of you on Facebook Live, please use the comments section for your questions. So our speaker tonight is Dr. Lane Valum, and Dr. Valum pronounced your name wrong. I apologize
no,
for that.
No, very, very, very well done.
Dr. Valum received his PhD in educating psychology with an emphasis in school psychology from the University of Utah. He has been working in the field of his study for 30 years, and he definitely knows his stuff. He currently is the coordinator of school psychologists at Canyon School District here in the Salt Lake City area. And tonight, Dr. Valum will be discussing and guiding us on how to get our chronically ill kids educated through the school system. So thank you so much for being here tonight.
Thank you so much for the invitation.
Oh, you're welcome.
Great
Thanks.
Opportunity.
So I would like to start by sharing what our experience was getting our daughter through high school. And about 10 years ago, our 14-year-old daughter, Kristen, became sick with ME/CFS and severe POTS and could no longer physically attend school. At that time, we were new to the area and the school, and we didn't know anyone at the school, so we just really were unsure of what was going to happen. We had heard talk that Kristen may get kicked out of regular high school or that she may have to attend an alternative high school, which didn't make sense to me. If she couldn't attend a regular high school, how was she going to go to an alternative school? And another option might be online school, but 10 years ago, those online classes were just starting up. They were new, and it was unproven, so we weren't sure about that either. We had talked to other parents in similar situations and learned that it could be a real struggle dealing with the school, and that it was even described as being kind of a nightmare. But in our case, that was not the case. In our case, we were very fortunate. Dr. Valum was a school psychologist at that time, and he was so kind and wanted to really do the right thing for Kristen. He recognized her potential right off, and we knew he was very educated and knowledgeable about the process, and for that, we are very grateful. Not only did Dr. Valum do all the work required to let Kristen get an education from the school, he set the tone for cooperation with others in the school, such as the principal, counselors, teachers, the administration. And that cooperation turned out to be a very key component of Kristen getting her education. Dr. Valum's work made it possible for Kristen to not only graduate from school, but to graduate with honors and receive an excellent education. Additionally, Kristen was able to take the ACT test at home through accommodations made by her counselor. Kristen had just a tremendous home and hospital teacher who made sure that she got her assignments and tests from her teachers. And this dear teacher even delayed her retirement a year so that she could continue being Kristen's home and hospital teacher until she graduated. Our daughter was even able to take some honors and AP classes, including one where the teacher actually videotaped his lectures because a lot of his material was outside of the textbook. So I think that's all amazing, but here's something that's even more amazing. Kristen was able to accomplish all of this, and she only set foot into the high school building maybe four or five times in that three-year period. And that's all thanks to these accommodations that we'll be talking about. So today, I'll give you a little update because of these accommodations and the work of Dr. Valum and the care from the Bateman Horn Center. Kristen has just completed her junior year in college studying engineering. So as I look back at the high school journey, I realize it could have been easy for her just to be pushed aside and dismissed because she physically could not attend class. But Dr. Valum, you didn't let that happen, and we're so very grateful to you and the school for doing what you did. So thank you for that. My hope is that this story shows the value of what we will be talking about tonight and why it is so important. So with that, Dr. Valum, you know, how do parents going through this, how do they get started? Who do they talk to? And if you would, just kind of guide us through the process.
Well, let's get underway. And but before I go there, you know, the story you just shared, you know, while there's great delight and it all worked out so well, and yet I heard it started out as potentially very frustrating.
Yes.
And I think that is all too typical sometimes. I think we're getting better systematically. You know, as I was even thinking on tonight and sitting down with you, I thought, you know, school systems are large, somewhat bureaucratic entities with lots of rules, regulations, standards. And as I think back 10 years ago,
right.
It's amazing, 10 years
it's hard to believe.
Have gone by, it seemed that a lot of what we were challenged with at that time and of what I was recognizing was we've got a bunch of standards and rules and regulations in place and they're not going to work for what we're trying to accomplish. Mm. So I think one of the things I do want to kind of segue to is, while I'm not an expert in this particular medical condition, I really needed to first learn about what's going on, what is not working, what are the barriers and things that are interfering with accessing school and functioning at school, which allowed me then to, I guess, start that process of thinking creatively, problem solving, and then frankly going and working the system and trying to alter, you know, why do we have this particular set of standards in place that's not working in this case? Let's see if we can kind of recreate and move forward with developing some new. So really, what an opportunity a decade ago to have, you know, your family show up and have this need, because it has paved the way, and I think we've come a long ways in a decade,
right.
And which is just fascinating.
Go
ahead.
I just, one thing that comes to my mind is, you know, we were trying to show that Kristen was improving. We felt that we needed to show some improvement, that this home hospital program that I'm sure you'll be talking about later was one that was not, you know, was temporary, and that we needed to show progress. And so we're trying to encourage her and see if our daughter couldn't at least attend one class every day,
right.
Or as much as she could. And that I think she was able to go maybe three times is all. And it was a very stressful event. And what so surprised me was that you did your homework and you did understand, because you came basically, we came to talk to you and you said, you know, this is too stressful. Let's find another way. I remember that. That was part of that journey.
Yeah, and clearly, yeah. You know, adding stress to an already stressful situation is no good.
Right.
And it's not going to work. We're just going to compound things. And I think as we do talk about creative solutions, there often is, and I think where you were at one point, hey, we would love to continue building upon something, you know, if we can get in. I think I can remember conversations, well, if we can get one day this week, maybe we can get 2 days or two periods next week, and we can kind of be building this up. And while we didn't, see that work out, I'm sure through that process, it almost compounded some of our efforts. And I think I've had this conversation, not just with this medical condition, but often when we're setting in place special supports, accommodations in settings, that everyone does approach it as kind of a cake and eat it too kind of scenario. You know, we want to kind of have it all and do the most, and sometimes it's just a little too over the top.
Right.
And I think we get there, and then we settle back and go, you know, give that part up and let's focus here and just go with what works. So just as I guess a general introduction to creative solutions, supports for medical conditions in our school systems, I guess I would like to believe that any person with any need could approach any school system, this is my overly idealized view, any school system with any request, and people would try to engage and work out a solution. Apparently that does not work, has not worked historically, and thus we do have a couple of significant federal programs in place that do protect and provide for students who have medical needs in a school setting. One of those large programs is the Individuals with Disabilities in Education Act, or otherwise kind of referred to as the special ed programs. And clearly, for some individuals, that may be a very viable path to pursue and work out some very formal services, supports, accommodations, modifications to things. Probably the more prevalent and useful legislation and programs federally, though, would be the Section 504 of the Americans with Disabilities Act and the OCR, Office of Civil Rights. The legislation there provides very good accommodations, opportunities for schools to put things in place that are legally binding. And I think that's the other, you know, it's sort of too bad we have to go to that extent. But let's get things in writing in place, and then we have some great assurances, and we can keep things in place over time. It's also a very convenient benefit to that. Okay. So I think maybe with just the introduction of IDEA, special ed programs, and the 504 accommodations, I'm wondering, does that spark a question with you, or is there clarification from the audience around those two programs?
So if I understand it, the 504 is a federal program, there wouldn't be any differences between the states.
Correct.
Basically. And then what about, where does individual education plans and home and hospital plans, where do they fall in? Do they fall into 504, or is that yet another level or another method?
Right. So depending on the school agency, you could, with just a medical need, put together a home hospital plan, or we've actually changed up the language a little bit and call it homebound instruction currently. Others are calling it just home instruction. But you could, without formulating a 504 accommodation plan, still access and put a home hospital plan in place. The 504 plan, I think more commonly now we would see those working hand in hand, because a home hospital plan just with an individual school district does not create that paper trail nor the legal standard and protections that might be pursued. So I think clearly in our school district, and I think most locally, you're going to see those probably going hand in hand. Typically we'll articulate the need for homebound instruction through the 504 plan, or in some cases through the IEP plan, which is the special ed programs.
Okay, so the IEP falls under a little, it doesn't fall under the 504, it's over here in the special education programs.
Correct. Okay. And
so when do you use an IEP? This gets complicated, doesn't it? IEP versus the 504 versus home and hospital. Is there any criteria or general guidelines on that?
You know, there is. The IDEA, the special education programs, actually require a school-based evaluation. So in pursuit of that, one would need to go through school-based testing, evaluations, to consider eligibility in those programs. The IDEA has 13 different qualifying areas, such things as specific learning disabilities, speech-language impairments, emotional disturbance, intellectual disabilities, orthopedic impairments, and a few more. It also has one category called other health impairments. So chronic fatigue could clearly, as a medical condition, play into a potential other health impairments classification. So that would be clearly one option to pursue, and many families have pursued that. Within special ed programs, eligibility also then has to articulate and have a requirement for specialized instruction. I think most people classically would think, well, that individual might need some additional specialized instruction in acquiring reading skills, writing skills, mathematics skills, and other kinds of school functioning. I think in the case where there's no real limitations in cognitive functioning, academic functioning, otherwise social functioning, an individual may go through that testing and be deemed, well, you're not really eligible under this pathway. So the great default, and sometimes we can already kind of assume this on the front end and guide, well, it doesn't look likely that we're going to meet eligibility.
Right.
We should be looking down the 504 accommodation path, and that path is a lot more expedient as well. You don't have to go through all that evaluation just to get a yay or nay conclusion. 504 eligibility, there is an analysis of the medical condition and an analysis of how that impacts school functioning, but that's usually done in quick paper review, sitting down with relevant team members, which would be student, parents, select school staff, to really just try to hone in on, okay, yeah, we all agree there's a need for some specific programming accommodations. So if that's the case, you're deemed eligible. It's a fairly easy program process. I don't think you recall it being really encumbered.
It wasn't, and we appreciated your guidance too, because it's like, well, what kind of accommodations does she need? Well, gosh, what's an accommodation, you know?
Right.
If I remember, I think we needed, did we not need to get a letter or a note from the physician?
That was extremely helpful.
That was helpful.
And that's an interesting point. Historically, most agencies, school agencies, have had a requirement of a medical diagnosis, mm-hmm. documentation, and still most folks have that, so it's not really a burden to present it. But there's been some interesting case law recently that has actually pushed back on school systems. If an individual is believed to have a medical condition or suspected to be limited or impaired in some substantial way, really school districts should not put a condition of requirement that could incur costs for families, could, you know, slow down the process. So right now I think a lot of school districts are wrestling with, we've always relied on that really clear, crisp diagnosis to kind of decide how we move forward. That may no longer be the case.
And that's probably good for this illness, because it's a very hard one to diagnose, and especially early on, you know, you end up going from doctor to doctor to doctor with no diagnosis.
You're looking for something else.
Yeah, you're looking for all these other things, and nothing pans out that way.
Right.
And it's it can be kind of frustrating. You don't know what you're dealing with, and so to come to the school and basically say, hey, these are the symptoms, we've gone to these doctors, you know, they acknowledge that my child is sick, but they don't know how to help her. I think is a relief to parents to know that they don't have to have that hard and fast diagnosis.
Correct.
And going on to the accommodations a little bit, because I know when we started this path, I really didn't know what an accommodation was. And, you know, so I remember some of the accommodations being, you know, an extension of maybe on assignments for like a week or a test for a week or something like that. Could you maybe give some examples of what we mean when we talk about accommodations?
Sure. Let's, so in general, anything that fits under the title of an accommodation should be just that. There sometimes are full-out modifications, but that's really changing up kind of the expectations or requirements. But an accommodation should be any kind of a support or relief we can put in place that allows the student to still do the full program, still complete work, compete, when I talked about sort of those rules and standards, you know, most classroom teachers have due dates.
Right.
And those work fine for most of us most of the time. But for some, clearly, it rarely works. And we need that flexibility. So I think just an obvious accommodation might be where a teacher would declare and have it as part of their academic disclosure statement, kind of their policy for their classroom. You know, things assigned must be turned in on due date. If a day late or if late, it'll be penalized or docked a percentage of points. Well, that doesn't sound very fair for someone who really can't regularly meet due dates. So not at all uncommon. A very common go-to accommodation would be, let's give some extended time to that. Okay. Let's give some flexibility. The size of that flexibility and extended time, there really is no hard and fast what that should be. I think that comes through problem solving and conversing with the people that it affects, you know, and past history. Well, what usually happens? What's typical? If you had a deadline for Thursday, middle of the day, and that comes and goes, what's reasonable? Could you get that in the following Tuesday? Is a three-day extension adequate? You've got a weekend built in there. That might give a student a lot of flexibility. So clearly extended time to get those in, and I can remember always highlighting this in the accommodations, without penalty. Yeah, almost as if you would, I always thought, well, you probably don't have to preach that to a classroom teacher, but apparently some were still like, well, yeah, it's 3 days late, so it's worth half credit. Yeah. That still doesn't work.
Right. That isn't going to help.
Yeah. So I think extended time on due dates is exceedingly helpful. Note-taking for some individuals, and that's more so if you have a student who's able to attend, right, but due to the fatigue of trying to cognitively attend to a lecture, and it really is kind of a multitasking event. You're attending to lecture, trying to get the message, and also taking copious notes, right, on a written format. So a helpful accommodation for an individual who's participating in the classroom might be, we're going to have a peer help with the note-taking. You can get a copy of those, teacher outline or teacher notes. Let's just hand those off to the student, allow them to have a copy of those, really focus just on the lecture part.
Wow, that's great.
Is a great accommodation. I think we can loop back, because there's just really endless accommodations. Sometimes helpful to reduce redundant work.
Good.
That
works
in some. Looks like some people have had that experience.
Oh, yeah. So, yeah.
If it's redundant work, and you know, this is an interesting conversation with classroom teachers, because out of the gate they'll say everything's important. Everything I've got on this homework or this in-class assignment has to be done. But truth be known, and especially let's take a look at mathematics. It's drill and practice work. We teach a concept, we work through it with assistants, and then usually it's, let's repeat about a dozen of those or two worksheets full of those to get mastery and kind of work towards automaticity and just,
right.
But that's not required for learning for a number of students. So then we need to sort of drill down and gauge, you know, if this student learns the concept and can produce it with repetition for them 2, 3, 4 times, they've got the concept. You know, and we let a couple weeks go by and we do a post-test and they still have that skill set. Mm-hmm. Well, we have evidence to say they don't need 20 of those to do. So knock it off. Let's reduce the quantity of redundant work and still have them get the essence of the knowledge and the real takeaway learning. So that's a fun one, but a very helpful one to put in place. I think when you shift to homebound instruction, or what used to be referred to as home hospital, and the experience that you had with your family, it's not... you know, 40 hours of instruction.
Right.
You generally get a teacher collecting up assignments from various classes, delivering those to home, helping tutorially, kind of, hey, here's what we're working on here, here's the next new concept, here's what this teacher's assigning you to do. And then you're really kind of turned over to, okay.
Teach yourself a little bit.
work as you can, when you can, and I'll be right back in a week or a few days, depending on how that's been arranged. Some people put multiple visits in place a week, some are on a weekly basis. But it's kind of a work comes in, work goes back out. Fabulous to put that in place. I think kind of looking ahead at some of the outline that you were wanting to cover, that is a challenge for schools.
I can believe that.
Quite frankly, if you're in elementary school and you've got one teacher, not so complicated. You get into middle school, high school, you've got multiple teachers, and you've got to orchestrate, and really the visiting teacher and the individual you mentioned, I recall, was masterful.
She was.
At gathering up that work, but also masterful at influencing all of the different teachers to do their part, to do their extra work on behalf of your daughter. And
she was very good at it, and I heard some stories that if she came to pick up those assignments and they weren't there, she tracked down that particular teacher and gave him 20 minutes to get those assignments to her. So,
and
in a very nice way.
Yeah.
She's a very nice lady, but she was good at that.
She was very, very talented at that, and of course that's essential to carrying out that particular type of an accommodation. You know, I am going to refer to some notes here. You know, I'll plug this because I would suspect families, as they maybe navigate and approach schools an initial time when they're first starting a process of trying to navigate and put things in place on behalf of their child or adolescent, people aren't going to understand. They don't understand the medical condition. You do need to bring them up to speed as much as you can. I found just very recently a nice, crisp, two-page fact sheet that's been put in place for educational professionals. Mm-hmm. That's a great thing to come through the door with and just offer that up. Okay? This will give you not a whole background on the medical condition, but given this medical condition, here are some fairly typical accommodations of what you might expect to see in the school. That the one I'm referring to is put out by the CDC, the Center for Disease Control. Pulled it up, Google search. It's like, boy, that's just perfect and crisp, and it'd be very welcomed in school settings.
And that's something that we can put up on our website. We will write a blog, you know, on it.
Okay.
Going through this education meeting, and we'll get that information specifically from you and put that up on the blog so it's available.
Sounds good. And yeah, any other stuff that might cover, just task me to go back and make a list of contacts or more information on IDEA, Section 504, things like that.
That would be great.
Happy
thank
to
you.
Share,
thank you for
share those out.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Well, don't let me interrupt you if you're not finished with your thought there.
No, go ahead.
Yeah. One of the things I was curious about, too, is when you write these 504 plans, and so ME-CFS and POTS, it's a spectrum disorder, and the symptoms can vary so widely. And then there's, some kids that can maybe attend a day or two a week of school or a few hours every day or
right.
Can't attend any, or they can attend, but they have cognitive issues, and it's really a struggle for them to retain the information, understand the information that they're trying to learn. So there's this whole, and everything in between, and then there's also the potential of a setback. So maybe you can make a few days every so often, or you try and do that, and then you have a setback, and it might be a month, it might be longer, it could be a week, it's unpredictable, where you would be able to attend school, or attend classes again. So how do you factor that in when you're writing up these accommodations, or can you, Or do you just take your best guess and then can you modify them? I've asked a huge right. question, but it's important, especially in dealing with this illness.
Exactly. Yeah. So I think answer your last part of the question first. Any accommodation plan that's put in place, or even if you move over into the special ed IDEA treatment plans, those can be altered at any point, any time, for any reason. And the individuals initiating those changes, amendments, alterations could come from the parent, student, school personnel. So if anyone's recognizing, ooh, what we put in place a month ago really isn't meeting our current needs, we just reconvene and get it right, or closer to right, right. and keep working on it. So your earlier part of the question where you've got sort of inconsistent attendance, intermittent functioning, hey, I'm good for this week, maybe I haven't stretched out a few weeks and I'm chugging along, and then things really worsen, and then I rebound, and then, yeah, just kind of as you were pointing out, right out of the gate, that's going to puzzle and challenge most school systems.
Yeah,
because
I would think so.
They're going to sort of, well, do you really need homebound instruction? You're here, and then you're kind of not, and I think unfortunate, too, this particular set of symptoms, syndrome, not everyone buys into it, like, correct?
I mean, you're very correct, and that is a major problem.
I know, it
all
is.
All the way around.
And you know, so if you get some naysayers or people doubting or going, well, I don't know, they were doing fine for 3 weeks, so how could this possibly really be that condition? Mm-hmm. Well, the reality, I think, with that is, well, you don't understand that condition.
Right.
If you did, then you wouldn't be shocked or surprised. Well, that's how it goes. And so I think that's probably going to be a challenge, in that schools are not readily set. They kind of would love, hey, it's all homebound instruction or it's all in-class instruction. But I recall we wrote a plan that allowed for, if you can make it, you come in and
right.
participate.
That's
and,
right.
And those were fun conversations with the administration at the time and the system at the time, going, well, haven't quite done it that way in the past, but it's what this student needs. So then it did shift that. So I think those are just going to be interesting conversations that families will have with school personnel. I would suggest you've got to advocate as loud and hard as you can that, nope, this is what's needed. So how do we make that happen? And I would approach it with, so how do we make that happen? And We know it can happen.
So, and it does happen.
And it does,
yes.
Yeah. So it would seem that the default would be you have in place that homebound process and then just welcome the student whenever they can participate physically, and not just for the academics. I'm going to throw this other little plug. There's a whole social component to
right.
participating in education. It's not just about getting the busy work done and learning the lessons, but it's also learning about oneself, learning how to navigate socially. So those opportunities should also be wide open and available to students regardless of what their current status is. And I see a head bobbing.
Yes.
Just
I was going to say, the socialization is probably the most imperative of anything, yeah. is to get the socialization in, whether they can do anything but sit there and listen. Then that's what they do, is sit there and listen and participate where they can, because you need the closeness and the oneness with your community, and for kids, their community is kids.
Yep.
So, and I remember Dr. Bateman saying something to the effect, this was a long time ago, so, you know, it's my words, not hers, but that if it's a choice between, you know, if your child is having a particularly good day, and if it's a choice of staying home and studying for that test or getting those homework assignments done, or going out with friends to, say, a football game or some school
right.
event, something where she would be with friends and socialize, do that.
I would agree.
Do that. That's better for her than trying to focus on the schoolwork.
Yeah, I think we never want to lose sight of that overall quality of life. it's tough enough as it is.
Right.
When you're navigating an illness, and boy, if your energy peaks, go do something that's reinforcing and work on those school things later. Yes.
I have a grandson with POTS.
Okay.
And he plays in the band, and he plays trombone and keyboard and all that kind of stuff, and marching band. And it's all he can do to march in the marching band and do nothing else, but he marches in the marching band. And then he gets the homework done when he can, because the marching band is more important.
Yeah. And he's tapping into all, you know,
music
education,
yeah,
and the whole social and connected,
yeah,
you know, you're engaging.
Yeah.
You're part of your community at that point. Just vitally important.
And then what you have to address is why the teachers are, well, he's out there marching in the band. How come he's not sitting in my class today? You know, so
right,
so you have that difficulty to deal with as well.
Yeah. But. Yeah. More than once I've explained to teachers, please don't take it personal. You know, your lecture in chemistry probably wasn't as exciting as participating in that evening event,
right,
coming to the football game or wherever you saw that student. So
you bring up teachers, and I'm curious, just generally speaking, how are these 504s and these different type of programs accepted by the teachers?
You know, I think we've come a long ways. It really was not too many years ago. We're probably talking two decades. Since schools started hearing about and embracing this notion of putting accommodations in place for students under this Section 504. So in the early days, let's take an example of a high school that might have 2,000 students. We might have had 4, 5, 6, just a few students who have tapped into such supports. Currently, high school with a couple thousand students, we're probably approaching 100 students who have specific accommodation plans. The good that comes out of it, and they vary from very minor adjustments, accommodations, to fairly elaborate accommodation plans, but teachers becoming all too familiar and seeing things previously, it's now, you know, it's more of a presentation. Oh, this student who participates in this class with you has these set of accommodations, and teachers that have gotten familiar with this just kind of go, oh, okay, all right, so extended time, yep, I know how to do that as a teacher. Oh, provide notes, sure, I always have those because I've got enough kids on accommodations that I do have notes to hand out, and preferential seating or prompting the student, reminding them to stay focused, whatever their
whatever
needs.
They need.
I think collectively we've shifted in a very positive way.
That sounds really hopeful to
yeah,
me, because I know that the struggle that the students go through, and to have that recognized by the school and by the teachers and the administration all the way down, I'm so thrilled to hear that kind of progress.
I think also you would have more parental requesting of 504 if they knew that it was available. Because there are a lot of us, I mean, me myself, when I was a kid, could have used help in areas, you know, I think, and my children, as they were growing up, they could have used help in specific areas if we'd have known something like that was even available.
So that is actually a condition in the regulations and the law, that school systems must proactively advertise and promote the availability of 504 accommodations being available. So what you will see, and if a district is failing at this, someone needs to remind them to get it in place. But I know in our district, we have it as part of the registration materials that families get. It's posted up on the front end of our website. We have posters in all of our schools, specifically in those areas where people are registering and meeting with school counselors and other support personnel.
So is the same thing there for people with mental health issues?
Totally,
yes.
Totally.
So are we doing the same statewide, like for our poor and our underserved, making sure that they know about those services?
We're advertising, and I know in our district we put that out in alternative languages, because we do have a fairly large Spanish-speaking population, so those materials are out there. We do try to train all of our staff that at the onset of a family sharing what their concerns or conditions are. We should be including in the conversation, you know, if you think there are accommodations or things we need to put in place special to support, we're supposed to be having those conversations.
That's happening for the homeless?
Typically, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
In fact, that's interesting to know.
Yeah. Homeless, and I mean, I know there's some overlap in medical conditions and mental health and homelessness, but across the board, we don't lump them all together. But we do manage a fairly large and support a shelter in our district, and we have dedicated people that know accommodations, IEPs, special ed supports, and they actually take the rest of us to task, making sure, hey, we've got a family just moved into the shelter, or we've got them set up in homeless. I think they've got a couple students who have IEP services. They came from out of district, out of state, and they get us moving real quick on responding. And some of that is in some other protective laws. But it's also the right thing to do. So,
That's good.
Yeah.
It's nice to hear you. That's the right thing to do, because you really preach that, and you act on it. So.
I hope so.
I want to change subject a
sure.
little bit and talk a little bit. Since we went through all this with you back, you know, 8-9 years ago or so, the online schools were just starting to,
right.
they were just making their entrance and really had no history or, you know, they hadn't been proven or anything. What's happened with the online schools? Is that something that you know about?
Oh,
would you recommend?
Yeah. You know, I'm not an expert in that, but it's everywhere, correct?
Yes.
I mean, the use of technology, online classes, not right on this topic, but I'm involved in hiring of certain folks in our school system, and we have people pursuing their advanced degrees going through full-time online education programs.
Oh, wow.
So I think and universities have been doing online courses for quite a while.
Yeah, they have.
And we do have, you know, freestanding. In Utah, we have the electronic high school run by the State Board of Education. Literally, an individual could log in, you set up an account, and complete an entire high school curriculum electronically, independent of any other school. Our district has also been putting together and offering online education. In fact, there's a requirement, I believe, and you know, I'm not currently working in the high school setting, so some of this is I've left behind, but in my understanding, we have a Canyons Virtual Academy, and students are encouraged to participate in at least a minimal set of online courses while they go through the current high school requirements, in part preparing them for, here's how you succeed at doing an online course. Because when you hit university,
you may be doing
a good number of your courses could be, well, you're going to take that one online, participate on campus with these. So as that flourishes and we see public school systems build that into their programs, and we know there's other outlying standalone virtual schools, charter schools that are virtual, private schools that are virtual, there are pathways that I think are very viable, and it's really changed in the last just very short number of years. If I recall, one of the challenges that we were wrestling with in your personal case was that often the homebound instruction or some of the existing kind of courses you could take might allow a student to, yes, I earned my high school diploma, but it was not necessarily tapping into our higher level academically challenging courses.
Well, we were able, and our daughter Kristen mm-hmm. took a number actually of honor and a few AP classes.
Right. And that was not always the case. It used to be sort of this, yes, you can get your diploma, but you're going to get just kind of straight up, here's your 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th grade English.
Right.
And so I think we've moved a long ways in the positive direction there. I don't know the status of where we're at currently with online courses. I guess that would be one caution. Can you get all of the challenging coursework that one really needs to wrestle with, and especially get those prerequisites that set you up for post-high school continued education. I know there's some programs that'll get just about anybody through the basics of high school, but they might not offer the advanced coursework to give you an advantage.
So I'd like to open up and see if we have any questions from folks that are joining us through Facebook Live.
We do have one question, which is to the social point, which is what are the types of recommendations or resources? Are there support groups for these students who are often isolated? And where would we direct parents or these, you know, their school counselor? Or
Right. You know, I think a lot of that, of course, is going to depend on if we can get the affected student in to this, you know, typically into the school day for some participation in activities. We do run targeted support groups in many of the schools, depending on what the needs are, and we'll pull some kids together. A lot of those are targeted, though, on probably social functioning deficiencies. So I guess one has to also assess, do we have really a shortcoming in skills in that area, or is it just the opportunity to connect? I think reflecting back on if you, and even in the audience, you know, if you've got an area that you can function in, just make sure we support access to that. So if the energy allows to march in the band, then we're going to make sure we optimize that. If we've got, hey, they seem to be able to pull it together and be okay to function during a school dance, well, then let's embrace it and continue going there.
I think also extending that to the community. You know, within the community, we have religious organizations, we have Boys and Girls Clubs, we have YMCA, we have
sure.
you know, whatever. We have a myriad of things. So
right.
try and connect with community-based activities. Art classes, there's a lot of free access. As if you were homeschooling your child, there's a lot of free access to homeschooling. Go under homeschooling, look what's available there, because there's tremendous quantity under that. And they can participate in those where they can.
Yeah. That's a great point. I mean, schools are not alone to help. I think it takes a village.
Yeah.
So those other avenues are great.
That.
Yeah.
So I think, yes, we have another question here.
So what is the difference between an accommodation and a modification?
So a modification would actually change up, would change up what the student is participating in. So a modification might be to actually alter the curriculum. An accommodation would be to, let's give an example, if a student can do all of the work but needs that extended time, we're just accommodating the time that we're allowing to get exact same work completed. If we were to see a need and recognize, you know, we don't think this student can actually do the work, and we need to put in sort of an alternate set of assignments, then we would really be modifying the, in that case, modifying the curriculum. And schools wrestle with that because they do have core standards and requirements. So once we start treading into modifications, it can alter, especially at the secondary at a high school level, if we modify to a degree, we've sort of lost the essence of what that course was, and that'll be really challenging to issue the credit then. You'll have teachers pushing back on that.
Can you
that.
Have modifications with a 504, or do you need an IEP?
Right now, I could get into a whole bunch of case law, because I think we're seeing some modifications and supports slipping in parts of the country under 504. Typically, you're going to see those more commonly through the IEP process, and especially in Utah right now.
You know, also have modification the other way, and I'll give you an example. I have a grandson who's extremely brilliant, but is dyslexic.
Okay.
And so he probably is in junior high school, and he's only 10 as far as his intellectual capability, but as far as being able to read and write, he's probably second grade.
Okay.
Modification, right?
Probably.
Yeah.
Yep. Yep. Probably.
And then under 504?
That would sound like we're probably better served exploring the IEP process under the Disabilities in Education Act, the Special Education, because if it would serve better to build from where we're currently at, and if we're reading at a second grade level and yet we're considerably older, we're going to need to back it up, work on reading where it can still be building.
We need to go into college next year if he were allowed to be where he is intellectually. It's just he's really struggling with language.
Yeah, it sounds like he's got what would really be kind of a profound, specific learning disability. And
right.
Despite being this bright, mysteriously things are not matching up to that. And
right.
Yeah, so we've got great, you know, those are more modified special curriculum that would then help him develop.
Okay. So we'll wrap up in just a few minutes, but there was a question, actually, when we put the announcement out that you were coming to talk, from a patient of Dr. Bateman's here at the Bateman Horn Center, and first she says, well, good topic, but she's the ill one, and she has kids, and she kind of wonders if there's some type of accommodation the other way. Is there accommodation for kids who have parents who are very ill, and they need to help their parents? And I'm sure this goes, there's lots of other cases like this, but this is specific to her. She's very ill with ME/CFS and fibro, and her children come home and they have to help do things around the house and outside of the house and help their mother who's ill.
That's a great, great question. So let me put a plug in for another resource available.
Okay.
It's called the Utah Parents Center. And I'll get you some contact info. You can add that.
Thank you.
The Utah Parents Center exists to assist parents in navigating and supporting the school system, IEPs, 504 planning. They're a separate agency that work in harmony, though, with the schools. Their big emphasis is to be an advocate for the parent.
For the parent.
So they
will. Are they state or federal?
They're state. Okay. The Utah Parent Center. And we've got a very well-functioning parent center in Utah. That great advocacy. We love to see them show up at meetings in our district anyway, because they just add to the conversation and they advocate for the parent. And they would also be well aware of other community respite care and ways to support. I think schools' part on that might be, okay, how do we further communicate with this parent or assist with maybe that carryover, the whole homework navigation,
mm-hmm.
because many of our schools are running after-school homework opportunities.
Mm-hmm.
So in some cases, like, hey, let's take that out of being a challenge at the home front from 6 to 7, 8 o'clock at night, and help with that at the school level.
Wow.
So when those children go home, it's let's enjoy one another and do other stuff.
Right.
So there's some help.
Since our audience on live stream goes beyond Utah, what about other states? Is Utah kind of a pace setter here, or is this pretty common in general?
Yeah, I think it's common because it does talk about support agencies in the IDEA, in the federal law. I'm not sure if it's a requirement or... hopefully it is.
Yeah. Something to check.
I'm not clear on that.
Thank you. Yeah. And I'll check one more time, Stephanie. Are we good there?
No more questions online.
Okay, and I'll ask the audience, we can take one more question, and then we'll need to wrap it up. Okay.
So I've got one. Resources was the homebound program requires resources from the school, like for the teachers that now we're spending time outside of the school with these students. And
right.
Obviously, it can be expensive. Do the districts find themselves challenged with the resources to do that? And if so, is there something that we in the community or parents can help advocate for funding for such things?
You know, it does incur some additional costs, but of course we budget assuming we're going to have particular needs. So, I mean, I don't think districts are caught off guard by such. Again, I would like to think these are the least of our concerns. But as we all know, living in Utah, public education, challenging funding, always asking the legislature. You know, so I guess from a community stand, you know, customer stand as a parent, just any nudging and just, you know, clamoring for assistance across the board for funding. But I don't think it's really posed the homebound instruction a significant financial hardship. And
So, Dr. Valum, any last thoughts that you would like to share?
If you think you've got a need, just act on it. I think there's a tendency to, again, kind of go back and, well, we'll just keep seeing if we can't make it work the way the school runs and try to fit our situation into their standard situation. But I would say waste little time if it's clear that it's not going to fit. Start the conversation. Approaching the school, hopefully all folks have at least that one person in their school system that would be their go-to, whether it's a school counselor, school administrator, or one of the teachers, and just start the conversation with whomever you're comfortable with, asking that person to help navigate to, so who in this school do I need to really access to more formally pursue this? And while I'm a school psychologist, and at the time we had primarily our school psychologists navigating 504s and clearly highly involved in the IEP process, other districts may have 504s managed by school administrators, school counselors, a team of dedicated teachers. So you really need to also ask that question. So if I'm pursuing accommodations, who do I go to? Who's your team? Where do I start the process? And if you don't get the answer you need, then start accessing any other creative resources until someone can help connect you with the people you need.
I think we need to really go after, as soon as possible, finding resources through the American Disabilities Act, because you need to know if your child can acquire Social Security, disability, money, funding, medical, whatever, and through Americans with Disability, you should be able to do that. And also through our legislature and our advocacy, we need to advocate for more and more and more of that, because we're still an underserved portion of the population.
I would agree. Good points.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Wallen. This is a great discussion, and it's going to help a lot of folks out there that are wondering, what do I do, how I go about getting my kid educated, and you know, I have a legal requirement that my kid goes to school, and they can't, so what happens there? And anyway, I think you've shed a lot of information that'll be very useful. And again, thank you for the work that you do in helping this group of patients and kids and their families in navigating the school system. So thank you very much.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you.